Well, a news that's just coming in. The government has decided that the orange passport proposal that the Ministry of External Affairs had proposed would be reversed. There will be no orange passports. Remember, the Kerala High Court this morning sent a notice to the government of India asking why these orange passports were being printed, were being made for migrant workers. They called the passport fundamentally discriminatory. This is in response to a PIL that was filed in the Kerala High Court. Now, the notice that has just come out says that the Ministry of External Affairs, in a meeting chaired by Sushma Swaraj, has decided to reverse these two decisions. Joining us on the phone line, our correspondent Meenakshi. Meenakshi, this, according to the government, the ministry received several individual and collective representations requesting a reconsideration of these two decisions.
Well, absolutely, Faye, and this is very significant given the fact that this news is just breaking, and this is a press note that we have procured just ahead of the start of the show, which clearly elucidates the background basis which the ministry has been compelled to take this decision. And primarily, it's been these individual and collective representations, as the ministry calls it, that it has received over the course of past few days. And this decision was arrived at on the 29th of January in a meeting which was chaired by the External Affairs Minister, Sushma Swaraj, in which the MOS External Affairs, V.K. Singh, was also present. And in the backdrop of these representations, they decided to review this particular decision, given the fact that it was drawing a lot of scrutiny and debate, Faye. And therefore, the key word in the press note is the third para, Faye, which we are in possession of, where the ministry elucidates that it is now willing to reverse its orange passport decision and willing to continue with the current practice as it stood thus far.
All right, Meenakshi, many thanks for joining us live right now, bringing us that breaking news. Meenakshi bringing us information that the Ministry of External Affairs has decided to reconsider or reverse its decision on orange passports. You'll remember, viewers, that these orange passports were proposed for those people who have not answered or cleared their 10 standard exams, effectively requiring for them to get a immigration clearance into certain countries. These are people who normally wind up working as migrant workers, and the Kerala High Court this morning sending a notice to the central government asking why these passports would be orange and would that not be discriminatory against certain citizens. Are we creating a class of second class citizens? Well, incidentally, we had planned to do an entire discussion on the orange passports to talk about whether or not it is in fact discriminatory. And my guests are still with me, and now with this fresh information that the government is reconsidering, it still though merits a conversation on why this was proposed to begin with. And are we a country that can in fact create a entire category of second class citizens? And I have a wonderful panel with me. Joining me on the show, Irudaya Rajan is a professor of the from the Center for Development Studies, Trivandrum. Rajiv Dogra, former diplomat. Kamal Mitra Chinoy, foreign affairs expert. Narendra Taneja, spokesperson of the BJP. KC Singh, former diplomat. Shashank is the former secretary from the Ministry of External Affairs, and Ramakant Gore, an advocate with the Supreme Court. I welcome all of you to this conversation. Thank you for giving us your time. I'm going to start with Narendra Taneja of the BJP. Mr. Taneja, we understand now the Ministry of External Affairs has reconsidered, but could you tell us what the government's argument was to begin with to introduce these orange passports?
No, you see, there are, as it is, you know, three different colors in passport. It's not that it's only the blue. There are already two other colors. For diplomatic passport, color is different, official is different. And if you look at number of other countries, they have a similar kind of system, patterns and practice. So it's nothing new. The whole idea basically here was that, you know, when these days, when you present your passport, the first thing the immigration officials at the airport do, they go to the last place to see whether the person has got immigration clearance, a required stamp or not required stamp. So idea was to eliminate that part, and just by the look of the passport, you can make out the passport holder doesn't have the clearance. You know, so therefore they go for a immigration check accordingly. So that was the whole idea, was to actually help them, help those people. And the whole idea was, you know, so I think the whole controversy, you know, those elements in our country, because there are lots of people who don't like the face of BJP just because the color was what it was. I mean, I don't know whether they want the saffron colors to be taken off from the national flag as well. And the Congress probably wants the saffron color to be taken off from their own flag. So I think the main problem was that, because people have problem with the saffron color. That was the issue. Otherwise, you look at there are multiple colors, and there are different colors being used by not only India, different other countries. And normally, you know, so there was absolutely nothing. It was only to help them. We have, you know, millions and millions of people living, working in overseas, mainly in the Middle East. There are about 8 million people working in the Middle East. Many of them are workers. They're not educated. I myself very often have found myself actually with no alternative but to help them to fill up the, you know, now that's, you know, not required, but until very recently you had to fill up the form when you were taking off from Delhi airport. So I mean that, you know, and you had to help because they couldn't really fill up the form. Whole idea was so that, you know, those they to help them and to assist them and to make it more convenient for them. But I think the controversy was not that. Basically, the people who launched the whole campaign because they were unhappy with the color saffron. Their problem with the color. And saffron is on the very top of the national flag. Saffron is at the very top of, you know, Congress flag also. And the saffron is a traditional Indian color. And if you go to other countries like in Switzerland and Norway, and they use red color because there's a popular color. There's a kind of national color there. It's our national flag. So people have those who have those that problem. They were the one who actually started it because they don't like the sight of saffron color. They don't like the sight of BJP. Well, and that was, they just created the whole controversy.
All right, fair enough. Let me bring in other members of the panel to respond to this. And I want to remind Mr. Taneja, we're calling them orange passports and not saffron passports. But interesting, argument to put forward. Mr. Rajan from the Center of Development.
They see orange, they see saffron and they see saffron and orange. That's the problem.
All right. Opening statements from everybody else. Mr. Rajan, Professor Rajan of the Center of Development Studies. Is this because Mr. Taneja believes there's a hatred for the color saffron, or do you argue that this is discriminatory and we'd be creating a class of second or a category of second class citizens?
No, the passport is such an identity for Indians. And you are going to code them with a color. I think that is again discrimination. And in fact, the ECR system itself is a discrimination, what we are doing right now. So I think we should not only now happy that the government has withdrawn the order of the orange passport. We should see to it in the coming immigration bill, there is only one passport without a difference of the ECR and ECNR stamp. That is very important, because these passports or the ECR stamp has not really helping the migrants either in India nor at the countries of destination. So the purpose which is felt historically by the Indian people or the officers, actually in the ground reality, it is basically more harassment for the people who are holding ECR passport, more humiliation, more what is called vulnerability. They are making it both in the airport, both in the POE officers, both in the customs. I think it is better for us to have just one passport. You want to protect the labor, unskilled labor or the low educated people. Give them proper training. We are talking about skill India in this country right now. Let us give them good skills. Let us prepare them to migrate rather than changing color or the ECR stamp. It has no implication or no welfare for the migrants.
Mr. KC Singh, former diplomat, do you agree that this is a hatred for the color saffron? Or do you agree that this is discriminatory?
What is that? Yeah, definitely. Well, that's what I was telling, because BJP, you are talking about an identity passport, like passport is an identity for Indian. When you are in abroad, you have a Indian passport.
My question was, one second, my question was to Mr. KC Singh.
Start?
Mr. KC Singh, please. Go ahead. Mr. Singh.
I said this is typical when they're caught taking an impetuous decision, which then finds the court will discriminate, will strike it down. You cannot have two categories of Indian citizens. I don't understand the logic what Mr. Taneja is saying. The diplomatic passport and the official passport, their status is different. They only travel abroad because they're going on government business or they're having those passports. Any other Indian must have the same passport. I used to be a chief passport officer in 1996 to 98. You don't know how much effort I had to put in because Mr. I.K. Gujral, first as minister, then as prime minister, wanted a passport for life. We told him it can't be done. You cannot give a passport for life. So then ultimately he did it for 20 years or so on and so forth. So, you know, decision making, the ministry has to take a stand when these pressures come or bright ideas come. You can't have different colors for ordinary Indians. What will happen will be, will they not have an immigration check if they have an orange passport? They will simply be separated and foreign countries will start looking for them. Because when they go there, they will target people with an orange passport. So it was not at all, it's an impetuously taken decision. Then they realize the court will strike it down. So I'm very glad that MEA has reversed it. In today's digitized world, inside the coding of that, where your name and so on and so forth on the front page is there, which is machine readable, you can implant something in that so that it shows up on the computer. We are in the 21st century. You don't need to have colors and so on and so forth. So the immigration guy will know, in any case, immigration will be required. Emigration check would be required for people going abroad for jobs who are otherwise not eligible. So that would still happen if they had an orange passport. I don't think that would mean that they can travel freely. That would never happen. So therefore, I am very glad this decision has been taken back. It created controversy. I don't think it has anything to do with the color. It's simply you cannot discriminate between one Indian citizen and another simply because his education level. Let me give you another example. Supposing somebody is matric pass, but he earns 2 crores a year. How will you know, one of the justifications for removing the stamp used to be your income level, not just education. Now that means you'll put the stamp there because he's not educated, even though he may be a multimillionaire. So, you know, there'll be any number of irrational consequences, which are, and I'm glad ministries, overturned it and they've gone back to the old system.
Yes, we are glad the ministry has, like the government has proven in the past, listened to feedback that they have received and decided to reverse their decision. Kamal Mitra Shiroi, you were a critic of the orange passports as well. Our constitution tells us that there is only one kind of citizen. We don't have different classes of citizens. But do you have a problem with the color saffron? Is that why you're criticizing?
I don't see why anyone should have a problem with the color saffron, because saffron is an ingredient in most Indian dishes. So why should people be against saffron? Anyway, the color of the passport is orange. And I don't think anyone has any problems with orange. But I think, you know, that I go along with Mr. K.C. Singh, but I'd like to make another point. If you are making the metric the yardstick for a certain kind of passport, we should remember that you have a lot of migrant labor who do not have a matriculation degree. And therefore, I agree fully with Mr. K.C. Singh that, you know, one should have thought this through. And the only reason there has been rethinking is because of a high court warning. Now, we should not get into this kind of situation, and about delicate things like passport and immigration, etc. These things should be thought through. You can't suddenly, because one high court reminds you, turn upside down. That's not a good sign for our policy. And this was done at the highest level. I mean, the foreign minister was there. The deputy foreign minister, former chief of staff of the army, was there. I can't understand how the snafu took place in the first place.
Rajiv Dogra, former diplomat, your opening statement on the orange passport, please. Okay. Mr. Shashank, former secretary of the Minister of External Affairs, respond to what the professor just said, that you're making such a serious decision that is overturned after one high court asks a question. Does that in any way discredit the ministry or make it seem like these decisions are not being taken seriously enough?
No, I'm quite sure that the decisions are taken on the basis of wide-ranging consultations. The problem is that the idea, for example, what Professor Rajan has said, did not go exactly into the making of the decision. Because what we are supposed to do ultimately bring up the level of all Indian workers abroad so that they can look after themselves. This clearance from the protector of immigrants is required in order to make welfare arrangements for these people so that they get at least certain minimum salary levels. They have given certain minimum standard of working conditions, and the protector of immigrants or the welfare officers in the Indian missions in those countries are supposed to keep in touch with the local governments, with the local employers, in order to ensure that the Indians are well looked after, because we know that there is a history behind the migrant workers and how the Girmitias used to be sent abroad in the British colonies or the other colonies in the past. So therefore, an effort was made after independence, but gradually we have to move towards a state by skill development, etc., so that people can look after themselves. So therefore, that decision was wrong, that we are now almost perpetuating the discrimination or the special arrangement for people who cannot look after themselves. We should make sure that they can look after themselves.
And does anybody want to rebut that, Professor Choin? Do you want to rebut that? Because it is true that it is the Ministry of External Affairs' responsibility to keep an eye on migrant workers and make sure that they are not being ill-treated in other countries. Does it make it easier for them to do so if they are able to quickly sift through who's a migrant, possible migrant worker, and who is not?
No, I think there's nothing wrong with taking care. And I think Mr. Shashank, you know, by referring to the earlier colonial policies, making it clear that the health, safety and well-being of workers going out from India is very important. But the issue is that you do not have to have a matriculation to be a mechanic or a plumber, you know, or a number of things without a matriculation. And standards can be laid down. But I think in this case, the decision was taken hurriedly. And the minutia, the basic little ingredients which go into making these things simple and understandable both to the migrant labor and to the country where they go, that didn't get worked out. And then you had this entire problem with different colored passports. So I think this is a part of a learning experience. Mm. And it is a good thing that this has been nipped in the bud. And I'm sure the MEA will take care to resolve this kind of problem. Because look, I mean, one of the first things that the NDA did in the last election was to say that, you know, we are also not affluent people. The Prime Minister talked of his upbringing and so forth. And so it is not the fact that you must have a degree. The fact is, what are your job skills? And of course, for that, there was a national skill cooperation there in place, but it's not functioning as well as it should. So that is something which also needs to be prepped up.
Yes.
So that it becomes easier for all concerned.
Rajiv Dogra joins us right now, former diplomat. Rajiv Dogra, the question is about the orange passports. And we do know that there have been several complaints, cases that have come up in the past from the Gulf, from areas like Saudi Arabia, where unskilled workers or migrant workers of India have been ill-treated, underpaid, made to work in horrific and live in horrific conditions. Does a different color passport make it easier for the Ministry of External Affairs to look after these people?
Well, not just in Gulf, but in other parts of the world also, whether it is Italy or Germany or England or anywhere in further north and Canada or USA, there have been many instances where our workers have been ill-treated. They have been passed on from one person to the other because the agency concerned had taken them for a literal ride. So the malaise is well spread, unfortunately, and widely spread. The color of a passport is not going to check that malaise. It's not going to change their fortunes. In fact, it might increase their misfortunes. And I'll tell you the reason why. Starting from our own immigration on to the point that they land, they'll be marked out as different. Do we want a new caste system in their identity? Do we want them to be treated separately and harshly? Because we are already announcing through the color of the passport that they are not ordinary citizens, they are not normal citizens. They are in a special category called unqualified, so to speak, either matriculates or below matriculate. The reason for this discrimination, the reason for their misfortunes is entirely different. And I must compliment our diplomats abroad who work 24 hours a day at times to take care of such cases. But the enormity of the cases is not because of these unfortunate workers, but because of collusion here in India and abroad between agents and employers abroad, who are doing it so that they could make the extra buck. So we have to attack that malaise, not further allow discrimination to perpetuate their misery.
Well, I'm going to open this panel up now for all of our panelists. Let me know if you want to come in with a point. Narendra Taneja, you've heard everyone speak. Ramakant Gore is yet to make his opening statement, but it doesn't seem like the color saffron seems to offend anybody. Those who are at this point disagreeing with the government's idea of orange passports, professors, experts, former diplomats, say it's because of discrimination and not because the color saffron is a problem. I actually dare say that they would have the similar argument if you picked a pink passport or a green passport. It's not the color that that people find objectionable at this point.
You see, before coming to your program, I was doing my research on Google, and with this kind of discussion on the color of the passport, if you really saw, it was all about the saffron, how many buildings have been painted saffron, and all linked to that. So you see, I've been listening to my co-panelists, and I agree with most of them by and large, except that I think discrimination is too strong a word to use. But the fact is, the political class basically have been trying to interpret it that way. They have not been using even the orange color. They have been calling it saffron. So being a politician, I cannot completely ignore, for instance, what they had said in the public domain, and you just have to Google
and search it, and you can do it right now.
But the point I'm trying to...
I don't have the opposition on this debate. There's nobody political on this debate other than yourself.
No, that is fine. But the point I'm trying to make is that this is what was there. So in the public domain. So that's what I'm discussing. And that's what basically I have brought to the table here, in the discussion. But as I said, the whole idea at this stage was that how can we help those people who are going, who are not really well equipped in terms of education, who are not very well blessed in terms of knowledge, etc. How can we help them? That was the whole idea. But if, for instance, in the house or outside the house, opinion is not a very good idea, well, fine. That we are a democratic country, a democratic party, we go along with it. Absolutely no issue. I've been listening to Mr. K.C. Singh. I've listened to the other co-panelists. I mean, it's fine. It's not a political decision. It's not something. Whole idea was to help. But if there are opinions coming from some experienced people, including those who are sitting on your panel, and they think that was not a very good idea, fine. I mean, but the question is, we still have to stick, we have to work on the same thing. How can we help those people who are not very well blessed in terms of education and experience and all? How can we help them? Do we need to strengthen our missions there further? Do we need to send more people so they can communicate
that's a fair argument, and in fact I am going
so
to
those
ask
those are the things. That was the whole
yes.
idea.
I will ask all of my panelists
the color and nothing else.
I will people ask all of my panelists of to give you suggestions else. On what can be done, because it's such an esteemed eminent panel and they will have very valid suggestions. Ramakant Gore, there was one person who told me that we're starting with the 10th standard discrimination, but if you start making different colors of citizens, that could then, I mean, tomorrow you could discriminate based on anything else.
See, in the name of welfare, what is happening is discrimination is proliferated. The Constitution of India does not recognize any kind of discrimination. The Passport Act is very much in place, which does not allow the officials to create this kind of discrimination. How come this malafide, unilateral and arbitrary decision came into existence just in the name of welfare? And the moment High Court issued notice, they are reminded of so many things and they are talking about democratic process. That's something difficult. My problem is that whether these are some political spokesmen or the administrators, they are banking upon Google research. The Constitution of India provides a lot of research. Supreme Court has passed so many judgments. Passport Act is in existence. They should refer to that because that provides us concrete grounds to take action. In the name of welfare, things cannot be decided on the basis of some research or material present on Google.
No. The gentleman got me wrong.
Sir,
please allow me 30 seconds.
Yes,
got
Mr.
me wrong.
Tanisha.
Yeah.
No, what when I said Google research, I was not talking searching on Google whether to go for that decision or not. I was referring to the kind of comments and you know remarks that politicians have made. I was referring to Google decision with regard to that. When it came to the decision, you know, that was after a due process within the Ministry of External Affairs involving senior and veteran diplomats who are in the part of the ministry, and of course the politicians as well. So that's how those decisions are taken. And Mr. Ambassador Casey Singh would be in a better position than me to comment on that how such decisions are taken.
But
the point I'm trying to make is the whole idea, the point I was trying to make is when it comes to the Constitution, I mean, kindly please, with all due respect to you, don't tease that to us. We know what's the Constitution.
You know
we
how to bypass that.
In accordance
I am very much aware of.
At the level of the Prime Minister, it's been repeatedly declared is the holy book for our government when it comes to such things.
Be it privacy, be it Aadhaar, you are bypassing Constitution.
If you have some better ideas, please share those ideas with us.
Professor Chirag.
Look, I think let's stick to the basic problem. Why this decision was taken earlier was basically to avoid people who were not adequately qualified in the job market abroad getting into problems. Fair enough. But I think basically at the root of this is, I of course agree there should be just one passport. But the fact is that there has to be help apart from the diplomatic corps in Delhi and abroad, wherever these people are going. They have to be given help to be able to qualify. And unfortunately, the only option for that is that the National Skills Development Corporation and other bodies must be made more answerable, more funded by government, so that people who are not matriculates can get a proper technical education and training so that they can work out. There is no other way.
That's a separate debate. Let me bring in Mr. Casey.
Rather than worrying about oranges and saffron. The debate is how do you qualify people to be able to go? That is a basic problem. It's not that the Indian government is deciding who is going to go abroad. They have to qualify by the laws of that land.
Mr. Singh, I want to ask you this question. We also understand in the same notification that came out 10 minutes before we started the show, that the proposal to remove the last page of the passport and no longer use it as address proof has also been withdrawn. The Ministry of External Affairs has decided to continue to print that last page with address and father's and husband's name and continue to use it as a valid address proof. Does this suggest that these decisions are being taken lightly and then being reversed? Or do you believe that there was a valid reason to make that decision?
I think they might have been thinking that Aadhaar will be the only basis for proving your identity or certifying your address. But what happens abroad? Because this passport also is held by a huge expatriate community. Now, if their address is not on that, if he's living in Dubai or living somewhere else, that may be creating difficulty for them there. Because you don't have an ID card or you don't have a green card to tell you that. But very simply, I don't think 10th will make any difference. See, at the moment, you've got Ministry of Labour, which does the certification, your Ministry of External Affairs, which gives the documents, and you've got Home Ministry, which checks at the immigration counter. So there are three ministries involved. There have been all kinds of allegations ever since the immigration stamp was there of jiggery pokery going on in the Labour Ministry. So I don't think the question is poor guys getting exploited there or also getting exploited at this end for many, many years. It's got nothing to do with BJP or any other shade of government. But what happens is when they land there, that basic rule of the employer grabbing your passport, now whether it's pink, orange or whatever color, once you land there, he'll take your passport away. And if you can't have access to your passport, that becomes the biggest problem because he cannot change his job. He can't run away from his job. Mm-hmm. Many times we've had to complain to foreign officers that somebody's passport is being withheld by the employer or he goes bankrupt. So, you know, the safe is locked up, all the passports are there. So difficulties, different kinds of difficulties are there, but you have to have some immigration clearance, just make it more efficient, make it more transparent so that people are able to, MEA doesn't get into it, but you get your certification. If you're not in that category where you are a highly skilled individual or capable of looking after your own interests, which means you're highly educated, you're going on a job, probably we'll have to, like US, categorize. US has multiple levels of visas. Then you have to create your own categories of immigration clearance not change the document. Document is nothing. It's simply describing who you are. But what we need is a check on whether they are going to a proper job, they'll not be taken for a ride. So there are various checks and balances there, because those employers nowadays, UAE's done it, and you know, Prime Minister is again going there, has done it where the employer must give guarantees. So, you know, if he doesn't, but I don't think that thing of the passport being grabbed has still changed in Saudi Arabia or UAE or anywhere else.
Right. John is on the phone line right now. We have people calling in at this point to give their opinion. John, go ahead. We can hear you.
Hi, Faye. Firstly, thank you for bringing up all the issues that the common man is facing today. And talking about the passport, you know, knowing that you are in a country like India, the discrimination will start right from the person holding an orange passport when he steps into the airport. Hmm. Right from the immigration, right to the customs when he's coming back, he'd be discriminated. You know, just like a person who's holding a diplomatic passport, he gets
special treatment.
Facilities, right?
Yes.
Yeah, special treatment.
Yes.
What a guy with the orange passport will get? He will get just the opposite. So I think that will be a big issue.
Well, that's a very good point. Let me take this point to Mr. Shashank, former secretary of the MEA. The whole point, if the whole argument was to protect vulnerable workers leaving India, wouldn't we be doing the exact opposite by discriminating against them in this point? Where basically we're making them wear a badge, and your passport is your identity when you leave the country. You're effectively making this person wear a badge saying that he's vulnerable, he doesn't understand his rights, and hence it's perhaps easier to take advantage of him.
Actually, I'm not in favor of people who are asking for this different type of passport to be removed, because originally the concept had come up with a letter of introduction from the mayor of the city from where the person was traveling to mayor of the other city where the person would be going. That is how the system of recommendation from the sending government started. Now we have tried very hard to get into agreements at government to government level with many Middle Eastern, with the West Asian governments. With Jordan, I remember we had signed an agreement that the government would insist that a certain minimum salary level would be given, certain minimum conditions would be ensured, and that local government would be responsible and they will take action against the agents and against the employers if any of the violations took place. But unfortunately, what happens is that there are not that many people going to Jordan. Many more millions of people go to Saudi Arabia. They want to go to UAE, where these things have not been signed, because in UAE there are so many of these emirates, so difficult to get some kind of an agreement on that. And I don't agree, I mean, that why should people be discriminated against? I mean, if ECR, ECNR, if that is not discriminated against at the counters in India, how does he mean that if there are a lot of people, millions of people are traveling, you mean that they would be discriminated, they will be kicked around by the policemen at the immigration? I just don't believe that. I think what I mean is that we are facilitating. Passport is a facilitating document, and whatever is the color, it is a facilitating document. Many of the Islamic countries have green passports. So it does not mean that green color, you know, that somehow will make a difference. The British have only one passport color. Even only for the Queen of England, they have one passport, which is red. For everyone else, they just issue a letter of authority saying that so-and-so is going on an official work, and so he should be given all the relevant facilities at the receiving state. So I think that many people who do not understand either the Passport Act or the practices which have developed, they are making this issue based on their own considerations, which is okay. I mean, this is a public debate and everybody has a right to debate on this. And we have millions of Indians living in the Gulf countries. Our major concern is how to make their life better. If we can have skill development in India, if we can ensure that the recruiting agents, they train them well in order to look after their interests. And if the two governments concerned can take action against any erring person, any erring agent, then I'm quite sure that work can move smoothly. So perhaps when the Prime Minister goes to UAE, he should, or to Oman. With Oman, we have very special relations. I think with UAE, we are trying to do that. I'm quite sure that we should be able to work out some arrangements so that the people who are going there, they are valuable people. They are providing skilled services, very good services to those people. Why should they be treated shabbily by their employers? And the two governments must be involved in this, and they should make sure that If the sending state is sending these people, they are all good people. We are sending them there.
Yes.
Many of the multi-storied buildings have come up. Many of the restaurants, hotels, etc. have come up because of the Indian workers or workers from Nepal or Bangladesh, etc. So why should they treat them badly?
Right. Professor Chinoy?
Well, you know, I think there's also a desperation to go out. I mean, the latest figures say there are only 78 million Indians who own, who earn $10 or less a day. So we are, you know, so these people are desperate to go. And I agree with Mr. Shashank that we must give them the training. We must give them the facilities. And most of all, we must make sure that there's a constant to and fro in terms of information and looking at what the workers are doing and in what conditions they're coming in, not only in the Middle East, but also in other areas. So that has to be done, and that is why we should not fiddle with the passport until matters are cleared. We know how we can get our people across, how we can train them better, and then these snafus will not arise.
Right. I am going to do one round of questioning for the entire panel to ask for suggestions, alternate suggestions to the Ministry of External Affairs, other than the orange/saffron passport. What is a better way to solve the problem that faces us? But first, I have Farhad Modi on the phone line from Mumbai. Farhad, go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. I'm not sure. Are we the first country in the whole world who have the two-colored passports? I think the experts in the panel can really let me know. And you know, why this special love coming to elections on this saffron color? First, they unnecessarily they paint the Hajj House saffron. Now they are coming with a saffron. Don't they have any other color? And why unnecessarily, you know, it's a peaceful country. Tomorrow you will have somebody from a different community traveling abroad. He may have a problem with an orange listing. You know, there are agrarian crisis. Agriculture is the biggest crisis we are facing in this world. And do you honestly think that a bureaucrat just give an order to the government, government passes the order and then takes it back? You know, we saw during the land agitation, they did the same thing. Is the government so brainless that they just pass an order and within 15 days of furor, they just want to create...
But you know, Farhad, I just want to point out to you that this was not something that had been passed. It was still in the works, and the government has listened to representation that has come to it and paid attention and, you know, reversed this this particular decision, which is a good thing in my mind, that we do have a government that's receptive and that's reacting quickly to feedback that it is receiving. Let me now ask my panelists, what is the better solution? If the orange passport is not the solution, what is the better solution? Irudai Rajan, professor for the Center of Development Studies, joining us from Trivandrum. Professor Rajan, Kerala particularly has several people who go overseas to the Gulf. How do we protect them better if not a different color passport? What is that solution? What is your suggestion to the government?
No, I think as we have advised through our studies, we are already having ECR stamps, but that is not helping any migrant. So the best thing the government really want to help the migrant, give them better training, because you can't provide jobs for everyone. So we have to create what is called the enabling environment for people to migrate. Now what we are doing right now is disabling them so that they have a lot of hurdles to go to Gulf countries. I think this is something very important. That is why I was telling in the beginning, ECR passports, as some people already told in the channel right now, they are exploited everywhere, from the custom, from the POA office, from the immigration desk, everywhere. That is why when we did the study 10 years back, I told to the government of India, MOEA, look, ECR passport means basically exploitation, compulsorily recommended passport. They are exploited at every level. So I think for that, India should provide what I call them very good pre-departure training for them. If you think people are vulnerable, give them good training in India. Send them like a very skilled people. You don't need to send them the raw labor. And we need jobs. I don't think India can create jobs for the coming youth. So we have to give them good environment. For that, this discrimination of passport will be basically disabling Indians to migrate.
Right. Same question to Mr. Rajiv Dogra, former diplomat. What is the solution now, Mr. Dogra?
Basic thing is, I mean, number one, let's be clear that it was no one's intention to introduce discrimination or to penalize people who are not adequately educated. So probably it's an experiment which is open for debate, and it's not a done deal so far. And that is good, because many new ideas can get thrown up in this way. But the basic issue is one of enforcement, whether a contract is honored by the receiving country where the worker is going, and whether the worker has been sent with good intentions and with good papers by the agent who acts as a recruiting man for employers abroad. So I think what is needed is for the officials in India to ensure that the exploitation ends, and if there are agents who are found to be wanting, then they should be made to face the law. And similarly abroad, whenever these cases arise, the government and its agencies, whether it's labor or whatever, should make sure that that particular receiving company is taken off the list of the recognized yes. companies. So rather than go in for a new color and so on, we should ensure that our workers get the treatment that is not discriminatory compared to people of same skills from other countries. And I must say that countries like Philippines or Sri Lanka have been very, very particular in ensuring that their workers are not mistreated. And in case there are reports, like in case of two maids from Sri Lanka, it had come to a breaking point even in terms of the diplomatic relations with Saudi Arabia. And that was not too far back. So I think what needs to be done is A, to increase the awareness among those who are intending to go abroad, and B, to ensure that enforcement against those who are tampering with the law is strict.
Yes. Casey, Mr. Casey Singh, your suggestion to the government of India?
See, look, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. You have to have somebody look at the agreement contract when it comes here. They're normally in Arabic. Salaries are not known. You take maids, for instance, many decades ago, because there were sexual violence cases or sexual exploitation cases, they said no maid below the age of, I think it used to be 35, could travel abroad. So they had a blanket thing there. Okay. Now, who checks it? Either you give this to the immigration, they'll hold up, they'll do all kinds of things, or you simply have the labor ministry examine the contract. Someone has to examine it. You have to just make your systems more efficient. And labor ministry used to be collecting a lot of money. I don't know how and where it's gone, which was meant to enable people to be expatriated, reverted back to India when they ran into trouble, because government doesn't have any money or any heading under which we can buy their tickets. So there was a fund which was developing. No one's talking about it now. That fund was supposed to help everyone contribute something when they leave on an immigration visa. But then that goes into a kitty from where you can get the tickets for people who need to be brought back. For every 100 workers, maybe 5 come back or 7 come back. So it had to be self-perpetuating. There was talk of an insurance scheme when I was in GS dealing with this matter in late 80s. An insurance scheme was again the same thing. When you are recruited, premium is paid. If like any contract, it doesn't work out, then the insurance company pays your reverse the ticket for bringing you back. So there are many things, they're all on the table. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. The argument we had today is just look snappier, nicer, to just change the color, etc. But in effect, really, you need to focus on labor ministry, on what you can do, quick clearances. Immigration shouldn't get into it. Once the stamp is there, they just check and let you go through. But you will have to have some agency examine the contracts.
All right. Professor Chinoy?
Well, I think
skills training. You said skills training.
Yeah, skills training for the workers, but also it seems there has to be some retraining for the bureaucratic staff at the airports, at the place where people move out of the country. And we have to strengthen our understanding with the foreign governments so that proper laws are followed on both sides. Because these people are vulnerable to agents, to corrupt immigration officials and all that. So no matter what color you make the passport, unless these laws are made to work and people feel free to go abroad, agents cannot misinterpret rules, cannot harass migrants. Unless that is done, this problem is going to continue. So the problem is not of the passport or the visa as much as the problem is of what the agents really do in this yes. country, in that country.
And Ramakant Gaur, you were telling me that not even 1% of those agents are actually prosecuted or jailed.
The problem arises at the level of agents. They recruit for the people. They enter into the contract. They are sending people. They are enticing a lot of people who are poor and uneducated. They are enticing, and there is no prosecution of that.
To leave.
We need to understand that this problem is arising out of that level, and we need to be very strict with these agents. We need to look at those contracts, and then if an agent is usurping the law, we need to
Let me take this to Mr. Narendra Taneja, because he has to leave. Mr. Taneja, there you have it, suggestions from our panelists on what the government can do, including pre-departure training, skills training, a careful watch and eye on the agents who are sending people abroad, and a self-perpetuating fund that that allows for people to be flown back, to be rescued from difficult situations. So there are a lot of suggestions. It's not that this panel is simply dishing the orange passport, but there are other options that we can use.
Well, you will see, in fact, our government take decisions. We take decisions. The whole idea is that how can we ensure that our fellow citizens, many of them not so well educated, when they go to countries, far-flung countries, and countries where they face some, in some cases, massive difficulties, how can we help them? How can we protect them? So we are taking hundreds of decisions and hundreds of new steps in that direction. The color of passport just was one of the hundreds of decisions we are taking in order to help them. You see, that's the whole idea. And that's, we have good relations with many other countries, and our relations with Ambassador, Casey Singh talked about Oman. We now have very good relations with the UAE also. We are working to build and deepen our relationship with a number of other countries in the GCC, area, and even beyond GCC areas. So the entire strategy is focused only on one thing. How can we make sure that our fellow citizens, when they go abroad, A, they are well treated, their dignity is not violated, and at the same time, they come back happy and satisfied, and they're well paid for their job. So we are working in that direction, number of areas. And as I said, the passport cover just one of the hundreds of decisions we are taking in that direction. So I like, so that's the, over a period of time, you're going to see, we're going to announce more decisions in that direction, all that we are trying to do. And we are sure that wherever, for instance, we are a democratic government, democratic party, wherever people think they have different ideas, they feel strongly about it, we have absolutely no idea to no problem with accepting those their suggestions, their ideas and all that. At the end of the day, we are only helping for doing it for them. If they have different idea, they wanted to listen to them, they want us to basically go along with their idea, we have absolutely no problem. But we are committed to one thing, that fellow Indians who leave our borders and shores, they are well treated, their dignity is not violated, and they are well paid, and their safety is of paramount interest to us. With these words, I would like to leave because I have to go to another channel. Thank you.
All right, Narendra Taneja. We also have Qureshi on the phone line from Mumbai. Our viewers are still calling us. Qureshi, go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead. Please, we can hear you.
Aji, main ye bolna chah raha tha ki ye jo inhone kaha ki dignity violate hoti hai, dignity violate to hoti hai ki jab har aadmi ek apna ek passport lekar ja raha hai blue color ka aur main lekar ja raha hu ek orange color ka, usse pata chal jata hai ki ye to labor class hai. Dusri baat, main ghar pe reh chuka hu aur mera bolna ye hai ki jo inhone kaha ki Philippines ko wo unko bahut zyada safeguard hai, wo isliye safeguard hai ki unki embassy unko wahan help karti hai. Hamari embassy ye karti hai agar unke paas to jata hai. सपोज मैंने किसी को आगे भेजा, उसका एग्रीमेंट हुआ, वहां जाकर कंपनी अगर उस एग्रीमेंट को वायलेट करती है तो मेरे पास ऐसा कोई पावर नहीं कि मैं उस कंपनी को इंडिया में बुला सकूं या उसके खिलाफ कुछ एक्शन ले सकूं. तो ये तो इंडियन एम्बेसी को चाहिए. मैं आपको बता दूं, हमारी एसोसिएशन जो है 12 लाख आदमी साल में डिप्लॉय करती है, 70 बिलियन डॉलर जो है रेमिटेंस आता है गल्फ से. यहाँ पर रिक्रूटमेंट जो फैसिलिटी है उनको कोई फैसिलिटी नहीं है. मतलब जॉब ऑफिस ये होता है कि वो बस इसका लाइसेंस जिसमें वो कर दो, सस्पेंड कर दो, ये बस ये लोगों का एक है कि इंडियन एम्बेसी लेकिन कुछ नहीं करती है. वहां पर लोग जब वहां चले गए तो हमारा जो मिशन है वहां पर उसका ये जिम्मेदारी बनती है, जिस तरह फिलीपींस सेफगार्ड करते हैं अपने वर्कर को.
Mr. Shashank, do you want to answer this question? Yes, Shashank, former secretary of the Ministry of External Affairs. We have Qureshi on the phone line talking about how he's lived in the Gulf and he doesn't believe that the Indian embassy comes to the rescue of Indian citizens overseas like other countries do. What's your response to that?
Well, I would say that Indian embassies in the Gulf or wherever Indian workers are going, they should be empowered to take up with the local governments and the local employers the welfare measures for our workers. With the India's rising profile, I mean, we had been last 60, 70 years when the Gulf became very rich because of the oil price hike, they were able to offer jobs to our people and we were very poor at that time. Now it is all different. I am quite sure that Gulf countries would be quite happy to sign agreements with India to make sure that their employers and their recruiting agents in the Gulf countries or anywhere else, they are brought under some discipline. And this should be done at the earliest. In our own country, we should reduce the regulations as much as possible and only go for training programs, for skill development, because that is much more. So encouragement should be here. The regulation should come in the place of their work, and the Indian embassy should be strengthened everywhere to give these facilities and to have funds available based on the funds to be provided by the recruiting agents and the employers in those countries.
Ramakant Gaur?
See, the laws are there. So there is no dearth of law. If anyone, because I need to respond to Qureshi, would you please permit me to respond in Hindi?
Yes, go ahead.
ने कहा कि मेरे साथ कोई वहां पर दुर्व्यवहार होता है या कानून का किसी का उल्लंघन होता है तो कुरैशी साहब इस देश का कानून आपको इस देश की अदालत में जाने का अधिकार देता है और अगर किसी भी भारतीय के साथ कहीं भी कोई दुर्व्यवहार होता है या कानून का उल्लंघन होता है वो भारत की किसी अदालत में जहां वो रहता है या जहां का निवासी है वहां से वहां वो अदालत के jurisdiction को invoke कर सकता है और appropriate कार्यवाही कर सकता है।
But Ramakant Gaur, for someone who's overseas at this point, how do they access the Indian code? This is my question also to Mr. Rajiv Dogra. For an Indian labourer or worker who's overseas, who feels that the the terms of their contract are being violated, their passports being taken away from them, they're being overworked or underpaid. And if they feel that the Indian embassy is not a viable solution because they're not as helpful as other embassies are, what is the solution then? How do they can't access the Indian courts because they are overseas? What do they do, Mr. Dogra?
Well, I think firstly we should look at the issue in very, very broad terms, because citing a specific case to castigate the entire system, I don't think is either wise or correct. Secondly, we should also look at the dimensions of the issue. In this case, let's take the case of Dubai, where there are probably more than 100,000 Indians living in just that city. And every second day, the type of problems that are brought to the consulate in Dubai would change their complexion. One day it may be the Dawood Ibrahim related issue where he needs to be arrested and brought back to India, or someone of his ilk. The second day it might be a worker who's mistreated by his contractor and is kept in slave like condition. Third day it might be a maid. Now, Indian consulate or an Indian embassy official does not have legal authority or policing powers to go and arrest that employer or that person who's acting against Indian interests or interests of an Indian worker. All he can do is to coordinate with the local authorities, appeal to their good sense and efficiency in order to get the justice done. So we should be very clear that Indian embassy abroad is not an enforcement agency. The second thing is there are physical limitations to our embassies and consulates abroad. Often we have a position where the number of officers dealing with consular issues, that means issues relating to Indians settled abroad, are not more than two or three. Yet in crisis situation, what you see is that the Indian embassy or consulate has performed much better than any of other countries. For example, evacuation many times over from Iraq when the two wars were happening, or from Syria and Libya and so on. So to say that Indian embassy can perform miracles, I think would be incorrect and maybe unfair to the system. But the fact is that more can be done, and more can be done, A, yes, with the help of the local governments there, B, as I have been saying repeatedly, by enforcing the system here with those who are real culprits in misleading, misguiding and exploiting Indian citizens when they go abroad.
I think Mr. Ambassador Shashank made the point quite strongly that you have to beef up the staff in areas. You can't expect an embassy which is short-staffed to look after the interests of migrant labor if there are 1 lakh or more. So, and also the other point that was made by him, that there should be agreements in effect with the that government and the Indian government of exactly how these matters will be solved. Because you cannot expect an embassy which is understaffed to look after a lakh of people. And it is in the interest of the Indian government and all the political parties that they beef up these facilities so that their labor can be looked after by professionals abroad if agents and others cheat the people who are going there.
All right. We have to wrap up this conversation here because we ran out of time, but very interesting suggestions being made by all of our panelists, including training of those people who are going overseas pre-departure to help them understand their rights and their contracts, to be able to monitor and prosecute agents who literally traffic humans into labor positions overseas, and to increase the staff at Indian embassies in order to be able to look after, you know, the people who are living overseas. First, Professor Shah used the term beef up. We, you know, won't use the word beef as much as we used to, but to increase the staff at embassies to allow them to be able to do a better job. But I think what everybody unanimously agreed on was the fact that the orange passport or any other color passport would be discriminatory, would point out vulnerable citizens who could be open to even more abuse and ill-treatment than when their passports were blue. So we're thankful to the government of India for rolling back that suggestion to actually print two separate kinds of passports. Thanks for watching.